don't want to sing alone. I need somebody to sing along with me. I won't let you sing alone, 'cause with you is where I really want to be. I have a love song I really want to share. Come, put your harmony with my melody, make it so much sweeter. You're the missing melody to my puzzled harmony, the two belong together. Can't you see? Can't you see? Can't you see? And your harmony, they go hand in hand in musical matrimony. I've struck some bad notes in my time, and my song, you know, it really went out of tune. Well, I've lost my rhythm, went out of rhyme, but I never thought I'd be back on track so soon. See, music controls me, it satisfies with this. This world without it, I just can't imagine. Harmony with my melody, I make it so much sweeter. Much sweeter. You're the missing melody, my puzzle harmony, the two belong together. Can't you see? Can't you see? Can't you see?
to my puzzle harmony the two belong together. Come on.
said we were lovers, nothing could ever separate. You said we had a love so strong, just like Romeo and Juliet. Now you've left me for somebody new, I still see you every day. Though you're far away from me, I still see you everywhere. And there's a picture of you hanging in my mind. A pretty picture of you hanging in my mind. There's a picture of you hanging in my mind. A pretty picture of you hanging in my mind. Alone in the gloom of my room, I think of the good times we had. Cause now I realize there is a line in between good and bad. The past comes back to me like a movie, with you appearing in every scene. Your influence has not worn off yet, I still see us as a team. And there's a picture of you hanging in my mind. A pretty picture of you hanging in my mind. Ooh, honey, a picture of you hanging in my mind. A pretty picture of you hanging in my mind.
Ending, not while your lips are so thrilling. The clock can't know what I'm feeling. These precious moments we're stealing. Clocks are for fools who make time for the rules. Please take the time to make love. Hello, no marques la hora. Porque voy enloquecer. Él se me va para siempre. Cuando van more. Y tu TikTok ni recuerda mi inevitable dolor. For the rest of the night, please take the time to make love. Dawn will be here and soon will disappear. Please take the time to make
yeah. but life's been kind. The town's been few. I guess you can say that I've been lucky. I guess you can say that it's all because of you. If anyone should ever write my life story,
till I heard him say, "Hello there, baby. I hope you miss me. I hope you know I love you." And I said, "I love you
sweet voice said, and it said, hello there, baby, I hope you miss me, I hope you know I love you. And I said, I love you too. I love you.
Can't resist. The wind was blowing my world away from me. I couldn't get nothing to stay close beside me. Everything was going wrong, it seemed. Some strange force just spoiled all my dreams. But now a great change has come over me. My fears have gone away. The sun is shining down on me, and I can see a bright new day.
Thank you. Won't you give me benefit of doubt? If I'm impatient and make mistakes, I couldn't stop myself before it's too late. Honey, help me wait. Oh, honey, help me wait. Won't you show me your love in some way? Would you still marry me? And when we are at the altar, oh, how happy I would be if my love seems cold and caring. Just reach out and hold my hand, honey, love me. I know you must go, but don't look at the clock. Don't hear the tick-tock. Come close. I want this moment to linger. I want the time to stand still. Don't let the clock move a finger. Not while your arms are so thrilling. Why can't we go on pretending? Let's say the clock isn't here. I can't imagine this ending. Not while your lips are so thrilling. The clock can't know what I'm feeling. These precious moments we're stealing. Clocks are for fools who take time out for rules. Please take the time to make love. Reloj no marques las horas, porque voy a enloquecer. Para siempre, cuando amanezca otra vez. No más me pierda esta noche para vivir este amor. Y tu tic-tac me recuerda mi inolvidable dolor. Thank you. that she used to sit in, his favorite chair, now seems so bare, so empty and alone. In the closet hangs a worn out shirt, that the shirt he left around me.
Would all but the family please rise? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Do you believe this? For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he shall stand upon the earth. And though after my body skin worms destroy, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and not another. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out of this world. The Lord giveth, and the Lord have taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. For I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, where my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not suffer your foot to be moved, for he that keepeth thee will not sleep. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Let the people of God say amen. You may be seated. We want to acknowledge the presence of our Prime Minister, ministers of government, those present, ministers of government past, officials from the various political parties who've come, all of the dignitaries who've kindly accepted invitations or have consented to come and stand with us at this time. We graciously acknowledge you, and on behalf of the family, thank you for making this occasion even more significant to us by your very presence. Every gesture, every kind act that you have shown, we're not sure if we'll be able to respond to all, but by the grace of God, we want you to know that we appreciate all that has been done to us. Thank you, and now let us proceed.
Good morning to everybody. Our God is good. Come on, join us in standing as we proclaim how good He is.
Your goodness is running after me. running after me.
Come on, say one more time. Your goodness is
running after me. Your goodness is running after me. It's running after me.
Lord, we thank you. Your goodness.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
When my life lay
down. My life lay down. I surrender now. I give you everything.
All my life you have been faithful.
Oh, 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 oh.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness. The goodness of God.
Lord, you woke us up this morning, so
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Say it one more time.
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Hallelujah. I will bless the Lord at his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So in the good times and in the bad times, we will praise the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We will now have our prayer of comfort with the Apostle Eliseus Joseph. He's the pastor of the Apostolic Teaching Center.
Let us remain standing for a few seconds to honor the life of Carolyn Eudora Leacock. Let us pause and honor the passing of an iconic leader, singer, prophet, transcender, mother, grandmother, sister, aunt, believer, and grace among us. Father, it's out of gratitude we pause. Because as we sang today, God is good. And all good gifts come from you. So today, we celebrate the gift of Carolyn among us. The gift of an entertainer. The gift of a nurturer. But more importantly, the gift of a transcender. Transcending our island, our mentalities, and exposing us to the greatness of the planet. So we want to celebrate the meaningful experience we have had with Carolyn, the meaningful moments, the meaningful relationships at different levels. The meaningful values that she transmitted to us in distributing the presence and the grace of God in our lives. We thank you for the impact she had on all of us, both in mentoring, training, and equipping for a global planet. Thank you for the grace that was manifested upon her life that today we celebrate and give you praise. Come on, clap your hands to the Lord. Lord, we honor you because all good gifts come from you. Thank you also for her extravagance that she demonstrated, her generosity, the purpose that she brought so many people into by training, by mentoring, and simply by speaking. Thank you, Lord, for the grace that we celebrate today. So we pause also for you to give strength and comfort and peace. Bring peace and give your fullness, your extravagant grace to Jan, her daughter, to Debbie, her daughter, to Nicholas, her son-in-law. We pray for the power of God to rest upon them and that they will feel the unlimited presence of God, the unrestricted presence of God in their lives. Lord, we pray for her grandchildren, Ethan, Aaron. You will strengthen them. May they feel the grace of your touch and the power of your spirit in their lives, sustaining them in this season of difficulty and challenge. Comfort them and embrace them with your presence, with your word, and with people around them. And Father, we also pray for Carolyn's brothers, Stephen. We pray for Stephen. We pray for James, Paul, Peter, Ronald. We pray that you will strengthen these, her brothers, with the power of your spirit, with a supernatural grace and power, and sustain them in this season. We pray for her sisters, Veronica, Esther, Joyce. We release your grace and strength and power and comfort to them. We pray that you will be very present help to them in this time of crisis. Be with them and enable them to overcome every trauma, every emotional trauma, every psychological trauma. Lord, cause them to transcend by your grace and by your spirit. We pray also for her nieces and nephews, Tony, Nadia, Marcus, Siku, Koli, Kimi, Jonah, Samantha, Candice, Nikita, Joe Barry, Seth, Shem, Jimmy, Jesse, Marley, Aubrey, Maureen, Diana, Wendy, Angela, Ricky, Ian, and Wayne. We ask you to comfort them today. If only you can do it. Give them the power, the strength that they need in this season. We commend them to your grace and to your power and to the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. We commend them, Lord, to your grace that they would receive unwavering peace and strength in this moment. We pray for all her friends and other relatives, extended relatives that are here. All of us that are here, Lord, we ask for nothing less but your presence. The unrestricted presence of God by the Holy Spirit. That's what we ask for. Give us so that out of this service, we will have a meaningful encounter with you, a meaningful experience with you. Because out of this service, Lord, you will extend yourself to bless us, to comfort us, and to give us your peace in the name of Jesus. And everybody say,
amen. Just remain standing a little longer. I know you've been standing a little while. As we have our Old Testament scripture reading, it's taken from Psalm 77, and it's going to be read to us by Pastor Thelma Graves, and she is the pastor of the Deliverance Temple House of Prayer.
In recognition of our Prime Minister, all the dignitaries present, every single person present here this morning, may I say a blessed good morning to you. Now we are going into God's Word. This is what sustains and keeps us in the midst of all the trials and tribulations. Psalm 77. I cried unto God with my voice, even unto God with my voice, and he gave ear unto me. In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord. My soul ran in the night and ceased not, and my soul refused to be comforted. I remembered God and was troubled. I complained, and my spirit was overwhelmed. But thou holdest mine eyes waking. I am so troubled that I cannot speak. I have considered the days of old, the years of ancient times. I call to remembrance my song in the night. I commune with mine own heart, and my spirit made diligent search. Will the Lord cast off forever? Will he be favorable no more? Is his mercy clean gone forever? Doth his promise fail forevermore? Hath God forgotten to be gracious? Hath he in anger shut up his tender mercies? And I said, this is my infirmity, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember thy wonders of old. I will meditate also of all thy work and talk of thy doings. Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? Who is so great a God as our God? Thou art the God that doest wonders. Thou hast declared thy strength among the people. Thou hast with thine arm redeemed thy people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph. The waters saw thee, O God, the waters saw thee. They were afraid, the depths also were troubled. The clouds poured out water, the skies sent out a song. Thine arrows also went abroad. The voice of thy thunder was in the heavens. The lightnings lightened the world. The earth trembled and shook. Thy way is in the sea, and thy path in the great waters, and thy footsteps are not known. Thou leddest thy people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Hence the reading of God's word.
Amen. You may be seated. Apostle Eliseus has been Carolyn's pastor, and Pastor Graves has experienced her in the training of her worship teams and the setting up of programs, Easter programs and Christmas programs. And so she has been a wonderful person to her. Hallelujah. Oftentimes the day seems long, our trials hard to bear. We're tempted to complain, to murmur and despair, but Christ will soon appear to catch his bride away. All tears forever over in God's eternal day. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen.
Oftentimes the day seems long, our trials hard to bear. We're tempted to complain, to murmur and despair. But Christ will soon appear to catch his bride. Tears forever over in God's eternal day. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Life's trials will seem so small when we see Christ. Oh.
we had to sing that one. That one was both my sisters' favorite hymn. Can see them singing it now. Let us stand again for our second reading. It's taken from the 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We are reading from verse 1 to verse 17. And we welcome our pastor, James Leacock.
Thank you so much, Minister Steve. I greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ, and allow me to say, all protocols observe. Amen. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that morality may be swallowed up in life. Mortality may be swallowed up in life. Now, he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. The judgment seat of Christ, therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known to our consciences. Be reconciled to God. For we do not commend ourselves again to you, but give you the opportunity to boast on our behalf, that you may have an answer for those who boast in appearance and not in heart. For if we are besides ourselves, it is for God. Or if we are of sound mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ compels us, because we, that if one dies for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live shall live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Amen. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. May God bless the reading of his word. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we welcome Ms. Jessica Odell Burrell.
Prime Minister Motley, members of the clergy all,
the beautiful and large, good-looking Leacock family. Artists all, brothers and sisters, a good morning to you. A special good morning to Jan and Debbie for inviting me to be part of Carolyn's going home service. I'm immensely honored. An undeserving, I'm sure, task, but I will do my best. Carolyn was beautiful inside and out, generous and funny, with a glint in her eyes and a wide and beautiful smile which drew you in, drew us all in, one way or another. Over 30 years ago, the length of time plus, plus, plus that I have known Carolyn and we became friends, there were many moods to this different lady. This was one of the headlines in the Nation newspaper on May 14th, 1981, when some of you were not yet born. This was following her hugely successful Carolyn in Concert at the Globe Cinema, a show of the caliber like we had never seen in Barbados, and could have been performed anywhere in a metropolis. I was one of the crew, may I say. I was Carolyn's hairstylist. What a night that was. Maureen Branson, who is here with us today, was her makeup artist. And Maureen and I marveled at the composure which Carolyn maintained between the many changes throughout the show. Composure was one of the things that Carolyn was able to master, even in the face of life's trials. It was an exhilarating show, and Carolyn shone. Maureen also recalled, with affection, Carolyn's discipline. That too was one of her attributes. This discipline was in reference to her physical training, and Maureen also quipped, it was a good thing just as well, since Ariel Johnson and Walter Soberts had the role of lifting Carolyn during one of the choreographies, and you know our girl was not slight. Solid, always tight. So they lifted her in one of the choreographies in the performance. It was stellar. She also reminded me that no one cooked red herring like Carolyn. I'm sure the family can attest to that. Other words that come to mind when I remember Carolyn are discipline, as I mentioned before. In the face of challenge, she stayed the course with that wide, warm smile which never left her, even when she was breaking inside. Excellence is another. This was her hallmark, and she pushed herself really hard, whether it was in the community, parish ambassadors, on the stage, even in family. She pushed herself to be that excellent person, and I'm hearing from Pastor Elysius even in more recent times, and you, Pastor, as she moved and transcended from the earthly things into the spiritual service that was hers all of her life, but more particularly so towards the end of her life. Commitment is another word I think of when I think of Carolyn. To everything she pursued with verve and passion, at the top of the list were her children. I recall when Debbie was a contestant in a show in the 1990s. Her project, just as her mother would have enjoyed, was around service. And that service was the provision of water in 40 Acres, St. Thomas, a place I didn't even know then existed. I know where it is now and I've never forgotten because of you. Carolyn was right there in love, Debbie, seeking sponsorships, spreading the word so that you could bring reality to the project. This was the kind of love and support that you had from your mother, amongst many other things that I may not know of. Her commitment to friendship. You could call on Carolyn anytime, and she would make the time for you. And I may say, even the last time she and I spoke, she from her hospital bed, actually I was trying to get your number, James, and she wanted to insist, call Jan, Jan will get you. I said, Carolyn, don't want your number, I can find it. And I did. And we communicated. She took the time, even at that critical stage of her life, having had a severe heart attack, to spend the time even to talk to me at all from her cell phone, from her hospital bed. That is a commitment that Carolyn Leacock had to friendships. Her commitment to her craft spoke glowingly not only from the stage earlier as we heard the beautiful tributes in music, to CBC last night with several programs, to messages from Prime Minister and others in the print media, her excellence to her craft, her businesses. Now, business is a thing in this Caribbean country where there is room for failure, but there's also room for growth. Carolyn never let her many challenges in various businesses over the years stop her. She fell down and got up and kept going again, and I would warrant even to the last, because a few months ago I was desperate looking for local candies, and I called her up and I said, Carolyn, look, I need to do. She said, but I don't do that anymore, but I can do it for you. And so she did, and it created an opportunity for me to provide the service that was required in the context of my job, but also gave her the opportunity, because we believe in spreading the work out as much as we could to earn a dollar bill when she most needed it. And she said to me then, this has come at a great time. The other word that is paramount above all and implores us in Corinthians 13:13. So now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, but the greatest of these is love. This love ever exuded by Carolyn and from Carolyn for all kinds of persons and situations and things. Her dulcet tone sang about love constantly. Almost every song we've heard today was about love. She did it with a profundity that only one who has truly given and received love, and yes, lost love, could express. She, like many of us, would have had down times, but picked herself up and kept on going. Fitting for caroling is a song by Shirley Bassey, which she also performed. Some may call it a little secular, but I crave the indulgence of the gathering here to say a few words. If I could sing, if only I could sing, I would, but that would be punishment today. And this is a song by Shirley Bassey. Funny how a lonely day can make a person say, what good is my life? Funny how a breaking heart can make me start to say, what good is my life? Funny how I often seem to think and find another dream in my life, till I look around and see this great big world is a part of me and my life. Sometimes when I feel afraid, and we can all relate to this, I think of what a mess I've made of my life. Crying over my mistakes, forgetting all the breaks I've had in my life. I was put on earth to be a part of this great world is me and my life. Guess I'll just add up the score and count the things I'm grateful for in my life. This is my life. Today, tomorrow, love will come and find me, for that's the way I was born to be. This is me. This is me. This is my life. And I don't give a damn for lost emotions. I've such a lot of love I've got to give. Let me live. Let me live. As we say farewell to Carolyn, my friend, a mother, grandmother, sister, and artist, I pray that all of the musings here this morning before and in all of the other places will inspire us to live acknowledging human worth, her life. May she rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen.
Thank you so much. And now someone that was tutored, mentored by Carolyn Nikita.
Madam Prime Minister, distinguished members of government, specially invited guests, all her friends, her beautiful family, Jan, Debbie, and the entire Leacock family, wish to sincerely thank everyone who has selflessly given their time and resources to make Carlin Leacock, Auntie Carlin's final curtain call, happen in a very short 2 weeks after her untimely passing. Our hearts are so heavy as we come to accept this, but we are grateful for all the grace extended to us. A very special thank you to Cancer Support Services, Allison Walks, Auntie Carlin's nurse, National Cultural Foundation and Mrs. Carol Roberts Reefer, Merville Lynch, QSI, Creative Junction, Renaissance Designs, Clyde B. Jones Funeral Home, and all the kind and accommodating staff. Pauline and Betty Bellamy, Adzil Stewart, Louis and Rosie Herbert, Brandon's Beach Crew, I see you, A. Rich Creative Media, Inspired Inventions, management and staff of Sir Garfield Sober's Gymnasium, Mr. Fingal, National Sports Council. The band ensemble led by John Rowett with Ricky Amy, David Weatherhead, Tamara Marshall, Marissa Lindsay, Natalie Burke, Mahalia Cummins, Jamal Slocum, the worship band, and their team. Please accept our sincerest and humble gratitude. My Auntie Carlin taught me everything. She was my dream. She is what, as a little girl watching from backstage because I couldn't watch in the audience, she exudes so much class, sophistication. I wanted to be her. This next song, she told me to sing. I didn't know it. She told me to sing it. And so on this, your final curtain call, love you, Noah. This song is for you.
Shattered, but I'm not broken. I'm wounded, but time will heal. And heavy the load, the cross I bear. Lonely the but here I stand, weary, still I press on. Long are the nights, the tears I cry, and dark are the days, no sun the sky, yes, and yet still I rise, never to give up, and never to give in against all odds, and yet still I rise. Sometimes I'm troubled, but not in despair. Struggling, I make my way through, and try.
Legacy, live on. I love you, Auntie Carly. Now, my brother Jabari would love to be here. He's in London right now, and he's a storyteller because it's not the Likots family without a story. And he made sure he sent something. And so, this is his tribute.
I ain't but your hopes one day, Auntie, to beg you for a song. Yeah. Born bird, were you very good? Leave your shoes there so up and not. Now, before I could get inside,
well, I can say it, because it's so good. Dedicated to Auntie Carlin. I went by your house one day, Auntie, to beg you for a straw hat. You're so weird, born bird. You're very good. Leave your shoes there, so open the mat door. Before I could get inside and kiss her, she said, hand me that newspaper. As I hold down to pick up, I remember coming up every Easter. Jamie, Shem, Jesse, eating don't she host and got she table messy. Running around in the back in search of the monkey and right carambola to bring back for she. Anyway, auntie, I need a straw hat. Before she could finish, she was at the back door searching for a certain hat with a string through years and years of performance costuming. She took up about 5, all different in size, but gave me one that fit me best. I gathered my prize, ready to leave in stride. She said, "Born bird, I ain't done with you yet. Come and see if you find something to tie around your waist." All right, auntie, but we got met his. Boxes and boxes of costume and cloth. So much things she met me put on and take off. What was meant to be 10 minutes turned into 3 hours and counting. For 2 artists were creating, escaping and reconnecting. I hadn't seen or talked to auntie for a couple of months, so there was much to catch up. And we laughed and had lunch. She said, "Let me clean off this hat for you, Barry." I say, "Auntie, fine, but we gotta hurry." She had it wiped down and properly sanitized, guessing she didn't want the dust in my eyes. She was wiping off the hat like her own personal treasure, almost as if to give her joy and pleasure. She said, "Take care of this, Barry." And she smiled and kissed me. Who would have thought this would be my last real conversation with my auntie? I put on the hat, and with you I wish I could be, laughing and singing again with breadfruit collage in plenty. I look at the hat and continue to miss you, auntie, a special straw hat you pick out just for me.
Thank you so much, Nikita and Jabari. And all them that like the breadfruit collage. At this time, Debbie Gibson and Jan Kaiser, the daughters of Carling, will come and give their eulogy.
Hey, Debbie.
Hey, Jan. You don't call me Debbie, though.
Sorry, Debbie Ann.
You don't call me Debbie Ann either. Call me Redness. It's okay. Okay. This is a hard one because it's really hard to take all of Mommy's life and encapsulate it into these moments. So bear with us if we go off a little bit. But Mommy went off script a lot, so
we stick into the
true Mommy and go off script. But allow us to tell you a story of Mommy, a woman who found her voice and embarked on a journey of thrilling adventures, sacrifices, and unyielding determination with a generous touch of class. Carling Leacock, also affectionately known as by her sisters as Carrie, and by her father as Lady Carling, was most undeniably a different woman.
She was the 4th born and the 1st daughter of Cyril and Naomi Leacock's 11 children. Mama and Papa, as her parents were affectionately known, were from humble beginnings, but they raised their 11 children with great pride and a love for singing and for God. Mama and Papa loved movies and music, so their first 5 children's names were from famous people, like Ronald is from Ronald Reagan, Ricardo from Ricardo Montalban, Barton after Barton McLean, Carlin, C-A-R-L-Y-N, from Carlin Jones,
no O,
and Janice after Janice Joplin. The 6 that came after, they all got biblical names, Peter, Paul, Esther, Veronica, James, and Stephen. Mom described her youth as very loving but strict. Being the first girl, she took on the responsibility as protector to her younger siblings. Uncle Paul remembers his grandmother, Verona, calling Mom away from playing with her friends to hold on to your little brother. Auntie Esther remembers Mom taking her to school, and this very close bond from then lasted her entire life. Her sister Janice was her ride or die partner. Straight shooters from the hip to each other and to anybody else who crossed their paths. Born just 2 years apart from each other, they were inseparable, even in their death, as they died just 3 days apart and will be buried next to each other. Mommy's singing career started at the First Baptist Church with her siblings under the tutelage of the patriarch, Deacon Cyril Papa Leacock. After several years of singing, Carolyn embarked on a professional career first with the Sing Out Barbados under Sam Tate, and her solo career took off shortly after that. I was born in 1970, sure? And Debbie was born in 1972. And Mom made sure from then that we were always at the forefront of all that she did. She always made sure that we were taken care of and protected, and that her tours and careers allowed for her to be with us as much as possible. In 1974, Mom exploded onto the scene during a concert at the Kensington Oval with the cover of Gladys Knight's You're the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. Mom toured extensively with bands such as Charlie and the Cyclones, The Escorts, and Chocolate Affair, gracing the stage of Madison Square Garden in Manhattan and other venues throughout Europe and North America. When Mommy traveled, we stayed in the safety of our grandparents or with Auntie Janice, sometimes with Auntie Esther, even with Uncle Paul and Auntie Lorraine. Her solo career soared to even higher heights as she grew as an artist, working with creative greats, like the late Jazzeree H, and subsequently with Anna Adamira. She delivered impressive dynamic shows with gorgeous costumes, beautiful dancers, and amazing stage sets and lighting. Carolyn in concert was first held at the Globe Cinema. I remember as a little girl walking into the dark hall of people. She was our very own personal star. She performed iconic covers such as The Clock, Goldfinger, I'll Never Love This Way Again, Touch Me in the Morning, If We Hold On Together, and It's My Turn. These and many more were always requested at her performances. She also sang Just As Long As We Have Love in a most meaningful duet with her sister Janice. Her rounded vocal warmth was often favorably compared to major artists including Diana Ross, Shirley Bassey, Dionne Warwick, Minnie Riperton, Candy Staton, and other musical giants. Carolyn in concert, Carolyn in concert, annual events at the Globe were international standard, flawless and dramatic excellence, not to be missed. Her concerts were cutting edge and way above their time, with dance, drama, costumes, and of course, Mom's voice, which made her universally dubbed as Barbados' first Lady of Song. Mom released her own treasured album, A Different Woman, in 1981. Local hits such as Take a Chance on Me and Love Me Still, these were all originals written by her brother, Peter Leacock, who himself was the lead singer of the group Lunar 7, while another brother, Uncle Ricardo, he was the lead vocalist with the Checkmates.
Overcoming challenges of the ages, races, sexes, and classes to rise each time and in true Carolyn Leacock dramatic flair, sashayed into hearts onto worldwide stages with confidence and class, which belied her humble beginnings and private struggles. Curious things happen to you when you're a child of a well-known personality. You learn how to read a room. Debbie and Jan, there's a time and place for everything. Mommy would say to us, or the gold standard of knowing your place and not embarrassing her. Debbie and Jan, ever so welcome, wait for a call. She would stress the Debbie and Jan, ever so welcome, wait for a call, just for emphasis. Jan and I went everywhere with Mommy. Mm-hmm. And as such, we were fed daily healthy heaping lectures of appropriate behavior. Drilled into our brains was knowing what to absorb and what to ignore. Mm-hmm. And hanging around musicians as little girls, there was a lot to ignore. Mm-hmm. And dare never to repeat or seek clarity on. We knew what was required for the occasion, and most of it was that we sat and we waited. Mm-hmm. Whether that was at Ken Jones' place, when Chocolate Affair was rehearsing, or in a typical cold recording studio huddled together, mm-hmm. or sleeping in the backseat of her vehicle while she performed in one of the hotels, we most certainly knew the drill. Mm-hmm. Looking back even now, I could see how this would have never worked if we were boys. Trust me, I'm a mother of boys. Mommy's fierce and overwhelming protectiveness of Jan and I demanded compliance. We dutifully avoided the rehearsals, sound checks, performances, and then traveling and shows. At this point, let me say that Mommy was a preacher. Mm-hmm. She did not make a move unless she laid out her instructional sermon that we dared never deviate so much. You can thank Nana for that trait. Once, when we were around 10 years old, we learned a terrifying lesson about what happens when you go off script. There, Jan and I were at the old Hilton Hotel, where we spent countless hours every week, as Miss Branson would know, as Mommy taught Keep Fit, still at the still elegant, lovely Miss Branson's surfside.
Yeah, and when we got to our grandparents' house after school that evening, we were supposed to stay, do our homework until Mommy came, but we didn't do that. So we were punished by having to stay in the car while she went to Keep Fit to do our homework in the car. So she parked in the roundabout area where the shops used to be, and we closed off and close to the front desk. Yeah.
So it was there in broad daylight, still in our school uniforms, mm-hmm. we being Jan, got bored, restlessly left the car, and a stranger got a bit friendly with Jan. Hesitantly, we breathed out this incident to Mommy, and explained to her what happened. And what happened next was a moment in time that life could have gone either way. Mm-hmm. Married at the time, Mommy drove to the nation and asked her then husband, Harold Hoyt, to give her his gun. Understandably confused and dazed, he questioned her as to why. And her answer was less of an explanation and more of a controlled, low demand, seething with rage. With a measured impatience, she opened her hand in anticipation for the gun. And in an instant, we were back by the Hilton Hotel. Up and down the beach, we searched for this offender. This was Mommy. Thank God we never found him. She risked it all. And she did whatever she needed to do, mm-hmm. especially to protect our girls.
That's right.
In turn, we created our own language. The three of us spoke with our eyes. A language we never lost. But when your life is on a stage, or studio, or rehearsals, in front of a microphone, words cannot be spoken. True. So they also cannot be heard. So we spoke through our eyes. We communicated through our eyes. We laughed silently with unspoken plans to later recap and laugh out loud. With our eyes, we were fiercely disciplined. All manner of communication was with our eyes. And when physical eye rolling would have been rude because somebody was annoying one of us, we mentally rolled our eyes together by just looking at each other. An especially useful skill when you knew with absolute certainty that the current situation was sometimes her enjoying some adoring fan or some random man telling her how sweet you look. So Simple tasks with mommy were like monumental. Like going to the supermarket, patience was paramount. Mm-hmm. Mommy would be stopped every two steps, at which time some other chat would ensue. And Jan and I would yet again stand dutifully by as that person gushed about how sure that she did and it was so sweet and fantastic, or a performance that they loved and how she should know them because she is their father's cousin, half sister, neighbor, landlord. And thank goodness, oh my gosh. And thank goodness for mommy's smile, a smile of a thousand teeth. Because with each and every time she graciously acknowledged and endured countless, and I honestly mean countless interactions. Mm-hmm. Although, of course, this lessened somewhat over time. With a trademark shrug of mommy's shoulders, she never snubbed anyone. Mm-hmm. She was kind and sometimes too accommodating with everyone.
Mom was funny as heck, and she was so mischievous. She could laugh and make you laugh so hard. I remember being about 8 years old, and Mom, Debbie, and I were driving down Bank Hall. And at the stoplight, we were behind an open back truck that had lots of planks of wood, and they were extending off the back of the truck. They had a yellow caution tape on it and rope tied around it, but they were so long, it was dragging on the ground. And Mommy said, "Watch this." And she lined the car up, the wheel of the car, on the rope that was hanging on the ground. And she just sat there, and Debbie and I are with bated breath just over the front.
Do it, Mommy, do it.
And she just put the front tire on it, and then the lights turned green, and the truck took off, and all the wood started to shake. And we are dying with laughter, and as soon as the truck stopped to check out what was going on, Mommy just put her indicator on past the truck, and we gone all laughing.
The wood never came off, by the way, so never. It's okay.
She was even so funny in terms of Debbie won a trip with us to Disney World. And Debbie called and said, "Jan, you ready to go to Disney World?" And I'm like, "Yeah." She says, "I won this trip to Disney World. You and I are going." So we told Mommy. Mommy says,
You ain't leaving me.
My mother went, bought a ticket.
We
bought a ticket. And it was just the three of us in one room, squeezed into one bed, having a blast. So those pictures you saw with her standing next to Spider-Man, that was the trip.
She was also a good driver. She was a real good driver.
Yes, true.
At some point in our very young pre-primary school years, Mommy, in all of her wisdom, realized that in order for Jan and I to navigate the cruelty and honesty of children and public scrutiny, that we would have to believe one thing above all else. That was that we were sisters. "If I shut my eyes tomorrow, you have each other," she would always say. Mm-hmm. So successfully was that drilling that Jan and I became inseparable. Much, I am sure, to her chagrin, when on my first day of infant school, I bawled for hours at St. Stephen's School, unceasingly, until they had to go and fetch Jan from her primary school class, to come and sit by my side while my little bright red face and fuzzy hair stick to my wet face. Jan was not impressed that she had to do this. Mm-hmm. But such was the bond that bound us, and such was Mommy. Mm-hmm.
So in 1987, Mom introduced Debbie and I to AFS. That's the American Field Scholarship Program. We're 16 and 17-year-olds applied to be exchange students to foreign countries to live with a family to go to school for 1 year. Initially, Debbie chose Italy, and I chose the USA. Mom abruptly amended our choices, and Debbie went to Iceland, and I went to Italy.
Stole Italy from me, by the way.
Let it go.
Never gonna give you up.
And Mom just said anyone can go to the U.S., that we needed to stretch ourselves and live outside the box. It was the first time that we were ever away from each other. And although it was very, very difficult for us at the first, it turned out to be where Debbie and I found our own identities and came back with growth, maturity, and independence. In 1994, Mom and her brother James, an acclaimed gospel artist in his own right, won the National Caribbean Song Contest in Curacao, singing Musical Matrimony. Staying true to the Leacock singing legacy, go ahead, they deserve it. Singing Musical Matrimony and staying true to the Leacock singing legacy, these competitive performances were supported by the youngest and seventh son, their brother Stephen Leacock, as well as dear friend Margaret Bovell. The proud national win was all the sweeter since the song was written by another native son, Stetson Red Plastic Bag Wiltshire. Carolyn continued to perform internationally at prestigious events and venues such as Carnegie Hall, and was also a staple performer in the local hotel circuit, including Sam Lars Castle, the Hilton, and Paradise Beach Hotel. At the Island Inn, Carolyn's cabaret was popular with visitors in Barbados and supported by homegrown fans alike, seeking the glitz and the glamour of the Carolyn in concert days of big band professional packages. After an extensive singing career, Carolyn used her creative talents in a wider cultural Barbadian arena. An unsung hero, Carolyn worked with the Secretariat out of the Prime Minister's office, where she initiated the Parish Ambassador competition, and worked for several years to see its establishment. It continues to be a significant part of the national independence celebrations to this day. For many years, Carolyn was a columnist for the Nation newspaper. She was one of its main advertising agents working on the launching of the Visitor magazine, which was printed by the publication. Mom was also an entrepreneur, bursting with ideas, which at times made her a pioneer in untraveled territory. She was among the very first to commercially manufacture, bottle, and sell wet seasoning with many hotels, supermarkets, and the Barbados Flight Kitchen as clients. Mama and sisters Esther and Janice worked with her to create the unique taste of C&P seasoning. She was not too aloof to operate a small sweets kiosk, which was called Sweet Tooth, at the Bridgetown Port with her sister Esther, making and selling sugar cakes, nut cakes, glassies, and other local candies to visitors who disembarked from cruise ships. Among her many talents was her natural dried floral arrangements. Her business, One of a Kind Creations, produced many unique pieces and beautiful floral arrangements, which were placed in foyers of major businesses, organizations, as well as homes of her clients, friends, and her siblings.
Among the dominant traits Mommy passed along to us were Mommy's passion for excellence, especially in all the arts, in fine, creative, and the literary arts. From very young, one of the things that Mommy taught us was how to write and communicate clearly, and writing poorly constructed compositions. Ethan, Aaron, in school and later letters of application or correspondence was simply not acceptable. No. It was write it, rewrite it, read it to me. You like this part? Change it again.
Yeah.
So my own writing and our own writing has received fulsome praise. And I remember very clearly the literary and exacting mind of her ex-husband and late Harold Hoyt, to whom obviously Mommy was married, encouraged me to embrace that path. And it was also in our gleaning.
So that busy, active, independent spirit that our mom carried, she shared with Debbie and I, as Debbie said. Seeing and sharing in all these wonderful adventures and experiences were sometimes scary, frustrating, but exciting. She made sure that we understood that we were to give our best, that we were loved and valuable, not to give up, and that we should give our all in whatever we did. She'd say, Jan and Debbie, if you clean the streets, be the best damn street cleaners you could be.
Nothing was beneath Mommy.
That's right. Mom rededicated her life to the Lord in her 50s. and a new spark was ignited in her. She carried this same passion in her Christian walk and took pleasure in using her wealth of experience and talents for the kingdom of God. She absolutely loved working with churches on productions, training workshops and worship teams and choirs, and building wonderful relationships with the young and the young at heart in Barbados and abroad. She wasn't slowing down, not at all. The Deliverance Temple House of Prayer cherished her constant contact and consultation. Just recently, Mom carried traveled to Guyana to train singers in the Roomvelt Life Improvement Center. Roomvelt, thank you, Auntie Veronica. Her skills were poured into Debbie and I when I won the Richard Stout competition in 1985. In her niece, Nikita, who you heard sing so beautifully, she came first runner-up in 2004's Richard Stout Teen Talent Competition. She continued to pour and share her skills with streams of young students who she lovingly called her babies, and they reciprocated their love to their Auntie Carolyn as she faithfully tutored them at her home many, many evenings. She even served as a judge for the Cropover Junior Calypso Monarch and the Pick of the Crop competitions for many years. Mom's life was not,
as her mother would say, a bed of roses. Mama. But Mom's tenacity in the face of adversity and her faith in God earned her a full and loved life. She loved a good laugh.
She did.
And held court over her extensive family, and I mean judge, jury, and executioner court, while who she hovered over and pulled together for gatherings, especially at Christmas. On many occasions, she acted as self-appointed judge, jury, and executioner over indiscretions, and her verdicts were final, reminding us all that she was the big sister,
the matriarch.
So what does Mommy's final curtain call look like? Our mother, big sister, auntie, Barbados' beloved First Lady of Song, she has left an unfillable void in this world and in our family. She had indomitable strength on and off stage. The falling, sometimes literally, once absolutely literally, at Frank Collymore Hall, she fell clean off the back of the stage. No one knew. Ripped up, bruised. First time ever. Biggest fear most performers will have is to fall on the stage. And pitch black, she fell off the top tier upstage, right down. And Anna de Myra said, "Carolyn, come on, get up, go." And she was hurt, angry, frustrated, just overwhelmed. And she burst back on the stage and performed. No one knew that she'd just fallen off like a 20-foot drop. So she pulled herself up and she got back up like nothing happened. Mm-hmm. She had pulled out all her stops.
Yes.
Her life was not a dress rehearsal. And that's what she said to us. And she lived it as best as she could and as full as she could.
She was stubbornly bold and beautifully honest. She loved hard and she loved deeply. We are overwhelmed with the many lives that she has touched and innumerable condolences, which continues still to pour in from our friends and families and other well-wishers all over the world. We are so grateful to God for the life that she shared with us. Mom, you will live in our hearts, in your teachings, in your antics, in your funny stories, in your wisdom shared, in your music. We will see you in the mirror and hear you when we speak and sing. And through us, you will live on forever. Yeah. We love you, Mommy.
Thank you. We love you. Thank you for who I am. Thank you for
for all the things I'm not. Forgive me for the words unsaid and for the time I forgot. Mama, remember all our lives. You showed us love, you sacrificed. Think of those young and early days. And I'm sorry it took all this time to see that I am where I am because of your truth. And I miss you. Yes, I miss you. Mama, forgive the past cry. Forgive me for not making right all of the storms I may have caused, and I've been wrong. Please dry your eyes, dry your eyes. And I know you believed, and we know you had dreams, and we're sorry.
Well, I'm the last of 11, and I came along and found it this way. If we're happy, we sing. If we're sad, we sing. If we're hungry, we sing. We just sing. With all the times that I came along, there were put you in front of the mirror and stand up and say, Stephen, stand up there, we got to sing. So Peter wrote songs and we sang. So we will sing at this time. This song is written by none other than James. And Carolyn loved it. She performed it a good few times, and we just thought that it would be fitting to do so as well.
Things were not going good. In every part of my life, it was raining.
I used to stand and cry in a corner by myself. Why it had to be me, I would be asking.
In the midst of my sorrow, a light entered my life, searching out the wet places.
A bright and sunny voice came speaking words of hope. Bright skies appeared, and the sun came shining through.
It's not rain, the rays of troubles and strife.
Now it's beaming down rays of love.
Beaming down rays of love. Ooh, it's not raining anymore.
Praise the Lord. It's not raining anymore.
That's right,
She's out of all of our pain.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord forever. You would notice that Paul did not sing. But he's going to come at this time, Pastor Paul Leacock, and he is the senior pastor at the First Baptist Church in Bridgetown. We welcome him at this time.
Again, let me say how grateful we are as a family. That are internationally known and regarded Prime Minister, the Honorable Mayor Moore Mortley, has deigned to be with us. We know that her portfolio and program is one that is wide and extensive. But took the time to postpone her business, the business of the country, to be here with us. So we thank you, ma'am. Of course, we are grateful, Sister Jessica, who, while in New York, served so admirably as ambassador in the ambassadorial team, in the office there, and served us well. To all those in the entertainment fraternity who have come, stand up, let the family see you. Singers, players, dramatists, hallelujah. Thank you so much for honoring us with your presence. So many others that I dare not call lest we anger our directors who have to help us pay the greatest respect to our sister and our beloved. But Prime Minister, I must tell you that this is not even all of the Leacocks that you have here at the gymnasium. If we had called all of them all, I think the gymnasium would be full. But you need to know that there's a significant family in this country, and all of us are so connected. All the Leacocks, stand up. Whether you're from Clapham, Lightfoot Lane, wherever you are, those from New York, Georgia, Zimbabwe, wherever you all come from, stand up. If you think you're related, you can stand up. Elcox, Maycox, some feather stock, you can stand up too. Hallelujah. Thank you for being here. I direct you to the Word of God. And the scripture that I want to bring before you is found in Psalm 96, a song of praise. Stand with me, let us read it. Let's honor the Lord as we stand in his presence. According to the New King James Version, this is what it says. Or sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He's to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the world and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Give to the Lord, O families of the people. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due to his name. Bring an offering and come into his court. So worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Says the Lord reigns. The Lord also is firmly established. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar in all its fullness. Let the field be joyful on all that is in it. And all the trees of the wood will rejoice before the Lord. For he's coming. for he's coming to judge the earth, judge the world with righteousness, and the people with his truth. Pray with me. Father, for this moment, we thank you. It is not one that we cherish, and we know that it is precious in your sight. Although it be filled with pain and distress that we cannot even fully express in this moment. But we thank you for your word that says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. We look forward to that comfort, Father. We look forward to it. For now our eyes are filled with tears, our hearts with grief, our souls distressed. But we trust in you, and we look for the comfort you promise, even the comfort of your Holy Spirit. Now grant it in this hour, we pray, that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord God, our strength and our Redeemer. Let God's people say, amen. Amen. Please be seated. I would be remiss if I did not mention one more person. And I know she's going to hate me immensely for this, but I risk that to say. Sister Jan Linton, if you're in the audience, stand up, please. If she's not here, Trudy, you're going to have to stand for her. Sister Jan Linton, an immense... Hallelujah. A dear friend and one who in this crisis absolutely stood with this family and took all the resources she could muster and helped us through not just Carlin, but Janice. And so, Sister Linton, and all that's connected to you, we are grateful. Let me encourage all those of you to support the organization of which she's an executive director, that is Cancer Support Services. Please put them in your budget for the year and make sure you are a blessing to them. Let me engage you quickly on the thought, Selah. Selah. You know, vast thoughts, all the speech that we can make is often condensed in many of our creatives in poetry. See, because life can be expressed as huge as it is in a statement, such as he was a man before his time, a phrase, a virtuous woman, a word, Messiah, and even a song, like Gone Too Soon, Lady Love, She's Royal. See, all of our lives are compositions, compositions that are documented on the pages of history here on earth. But they're recorded permanently in the books of heaven, and therefore we need to pause and reflect. And that's what Selah says, pause and reflect. Why? We have to ask ourselves as we live, are we living acceptably or unacceptably in the sight of God? And how we live our lives is expressed in our words, in our behavior. Our lives is like a score of music that can be seen and heard by other people. From conception to your last breath, your song, your life is like a song. Each day, each birthday, each decade we walk along the paths of life, we leave sick footprints in the sands of time. Our words, our living is etched in the midst of those and the minds of those who share our lives. And that's why we can write autobiographies or biographies of others. Many times we take license to comment on other people's lives, don't we? We compose opinions about people. We reduce them to our own conclusions. We commend and we condemn. And we're going to do so today as well, as we honor one who in death Leacock's journey is now ended. But what is her true epitaph, Carlin? What will we say that truly summarizes her? What is the real full expression of that dash between the day you were born and the day you die? That dash. You've taken last glances at her body, but we have to ask the question, do they really capture who she is? Is that all to her? And then there's the hearsay, the chance encounters, the distance performances, but in it all, there are only a few that really have intimate relationships, but none of us, whether family or not, fully know the story of her life. But heaven does. Carlin's life, like ours, can be reduced to one song. Not the clock, not loving a song, not take a chance on me. Not even in the song she sang at our Mother's Day program recently. The Prime Minister, the congregation looked at me and said, well, you know, you ain't gonna preach, no. When she sang in Jesus' name, that some regards as her swan song. Her entire life has composed the song, and heaven has heard it, like it's hearing our unfinished versions while we live right now. What did her life say for the 73 years it was given? What are the verses, the chorus, the hook line? What was the essential rhythm of her heartbeat? What did each breath vocalize until it reached its final crescendo that many of us stood by in here? You see, heaven's language is not what we speak here on earth. I am exploring the thought, apostle, pastor, that the language of heaven is music, and few hear it. There's some who have heard it, like Isaiah, who said he saw the Lord and he heard the cherubim singing. And what were they singing? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Jonathan Heber did a cover of that song, and many of you know it quite well. Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty. John and others saw in the Revelation, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. The angels sang that song, and many of us who are in praise teams that sing that song, many artists. And then there's that song, Hallelujah and Amen, for the Lord God Almighty reigns, which the elders of heaven, the beast of heaven, sang, and it's beautifully covered. All of us know Handel's Messiah's rendering of it. Do we know it? Can you remember it? It's the Hallelujah chorus, isn't it? And we sing it. You see, heaven lent us music that we may praise the Lord, the one who gave the spiritual power, so that we can teach one another the virtues of love and justice and mercy and peace. Alas, earth's language is quite vicious, isn't it? Our actions are often savage. But music is that universal language that God has given us. That, as one says, soothes the savage breast. And God has encoded heaven's music, heaven's praise and worship in all of creation. It's in our heartbeats. It's in the blood that flows through our veins. It's in the symmetry, the symmetric rhythm of our bodies. It's in the whistling wind. It's in the crash of the waves against the rocks. It's in the fury of the storm. We hear it in the tranquil flow of the stream and in even the silence of the passing clouds. In the whistling of birds, we hear it in the song of creatures, even the cooing of a child. In every instrument that we have invented that expresses how we really feel. And in all of this, we ought to be able to sing praises to the Lord. Unfortunately, also often we sing praises to ourselves. Dance and seduce each other with the music. We reduce and ridicule each other with music. We regale, we rejoice with each other. And many times we rudely and shamefully with vulgarity use music that excludes God. We even monetize our talents and to enrich ourselves, and we allow ourselves to become idols. We elevate ourselves above the masses of fans, and we forget to give the one who gave us these creative gifts, our creator, the credit for the musical talents that we have. And we need to remember that it's only praise that matters in heaven's ears. Doesn't matter how many Grammys you have. It doesn't matter how many stages you are able to stand upon. Heaven only acknowledges praise. But you know, we can change that. One inspirational song that I call to mind says, "Once my life was all discordant, music in a minor key. Till one day I met the master and he changed all that for me. Life is a symphony since that man from Galilee turned my midnight into song and makes life sweet the whole day long." Yeah. Fanny Crosby, though she was blind, was a prolific hymn writer. And she said, "Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that are broken can vibrate once more." And if you went to church, you know the chorus of that song that says, "Rescue the care for the dark, Jesus. Jesus will say." Some people live their lives, and I told you that life is a song. We can reduce it to a song. And some people live their lives like selfish solos. Me, 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 me. That's the only note they know. Don't try them on the triad, they'll get them messed up. "I'm an others harmonize in love." They sing duets and trios and quartets, and they're even part of choirs. And David wrote a song about that in Psalm 133 and verse 1. He says, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." There's some who blatantly sing off key, discordant. In the words of my former voice coach, Miss Doris Provençal, who took no slack, said that you made noise and not music. What does your life song like to heaven? What's the song track of your life? Has God given any praise? How about on the ZRs? The limes, the cruises, the crawls. I call to mind John Newton. He was a wretch of a man, lived a wanton life. He was at one time the captain of a slave ship. Our African ancestors was his human cargo. He came loaded, destined for the Caribbean. and the Americas, slave plantations. His life was an unbearable sound in the ears of God. And God does something when that happens. He sent a powerful storm one day, and John Newton realized this is one he can't ride out, and he prayed to God that if he would save him, he would serve him. The Lord must have heard his prayers, because after he survived, his penitent heart caused him to write the song, Amazing Grace. How sweet the song that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Reverend Whitley Phipps, an excellent baritone singer, says that he don't think that that was original. He think that he, that John Newton, because the song is sung on the black notes, just like the spirituals. And he said that he must have copied that from the moans that he heard below deck. Dr. Joy Degree Leary, one who purports to talk about post-traumatic slave syndrome, posits that none of us who are deeply melanated should sing that song. She said, that's the slaver's song. Let them sing it. Those are the wretches that need to be saved. Slaves have their own songs, though. We talk about transcendence today. They were able to transcend above their pain and their stress. And their praise lifted them above the oppression that they were exposed to. And heaven heard their cries against their evil masters. Sounds like old Mary, don't you weep, don't you mourn. Because Pharaoh's army got drowned. It'll soon be done, these troubles and trials. When I get home on the other side, and oh, freedom, oh, freedom. And before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. We may not realize it, but you know Jesus sang too? He sang. The Bible tells us that his life was a hit song for years. He sang at the Last Supper, do you know that? Before he went to his death. And even on the cross, he groaned out a prayer. He groaned out a praise on his quivering, dying lips. He recited the song of praise, Psalm 22, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? His life was a song of love, mercy, grace, power, healing, deliverance, and of course, salvation. It so pleased God that when he died, God raised him again and set him at his right hand, and now he's being praised by all creatures everywhere. Well, Carlin began her life praising God. All of us did, before the cocks were crowing. And all of us had to sit around the beds, and we would read the scripture, and we would sing. And he would teach us harmony. We don't know where he found the time, going to work from 7 in the morning and all the way to 11 at the Bridgestone port. He had to work that long because he had a lot of kids to feed. She began praising God then. But her prayers of relationships, failed marriages, public scorn, she entertained. But let me tell you that she was a worshiper of God. And she returned to the Lord, her first love. She taught praise and worship teams. She joined her brothers in singing the songs of the Lord. She moved away from the spotlight of the earth. And she began to sing the last 25 years for the applause of heaven. But let me tell you that she has not sung her greatest song yet. She's going to be part of Heaven's Mass Choir. And that choir will emerge from great tribulation. Robes they're going to wear, washed in the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ. And they're going to be there waving palm branches in their hands and singing a song in a multitude that none can number. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. That's the song of earth to heaven. And the angels and the 24 elders and the four beasts around the throne of God, when they hear that song, they're going to fall on their faces to worship. And they're going to do a call and response. Amen, they will say. Blessings and glory and honor and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Forever she's going to be in his presence. She's going to hunger no more, thirst no more. The sun will not burn her anymore because, you see, the Lamb is going to be in the midst of the throne. She'll feed her, says the word of God, and shall lead her unto the fountain of living waters. And God shall wipe away all tears from her eyes. That's going to be her best performance. Let me ask you this morning, what's your life song? It's playing right now. Can you hear it? Others can. God can. What does heaven hear you saying, singing? Pause, sailor. Listen to your words and to your deeds. Who is your real audience? Who are you singing to please? You can sing a new song today. You can cancel that old contract. We can give you a good one. We give you a covenant with God. Are you singing to please God? But you can change your tune if you're not. You can change your genre of music. You don't have to please the crowd at the expense of your soul. You may only end up like so many, empty, forgotten, faded into history. You can come and join this hallelujah chorus. You can join the people of God that say or sing unto the Lord a new song. For he has done marvelous things. There's a reason why we should sing to the Lord. He's done marvelous things. Huh? Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Let his name be the name that prospers. Not the names that are up in lights, but the name that gives light. Sing to the Lord. Proclaim in your singing, in your music, the good news of his salvation every day. Your life should be a song that declares his glory among the nations and his wonders among all people. Why? Because the Lord is great. He doesn't become great. You can become great. People can know you. You can grace the covers of magazines, and you can be on Billboard. You can be on Rolling Stone. But God doesn't become great. God is great and greatly to be praised. And he's to be feared above all gods. All the gods are mere idols, but it's the Lord that made the heavens. Amen. He's honorable. He's majestic. He's the one that has the strength and beauty in his sanctuary. Not the one that makes you up just so that the crowd can see you, and you have to keep up those appearances, but he's the one that beautifies you and strengthens you. So give to the Lord, families of the people, give to the Lord glory and strength. Give the Lord the glory that is due to his name. Bring an offering, says this song of praise, and come into his courts and worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. And say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world also is firmly established, and it shall not be moved, because God is going to judge his people righteously. He's going to come and he's going to judge. And when he judges, what's going to be your song? Some people are happy that they have platinum records on their walls, gold records. But the Bible tells us when he comes to judge, he's going to test your works. They're going to pass through the fire. And you know that good gold comes out pure. All the slag and all the impurities bubble to the top, and they're skimmed off, and the 24 karat is there. Precious stones. But all the works that may matter to others, when it goes through God's fire, it'll only amount to wood, hay, stubble, and you know what happens to that? They become ashes. So let the heavens rejoice today, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roll it in its fullness. Let the very fields be joyful and all that's in them. Let the trees of the wood rejoice, because he's coming. He's coming to judge the earth, and he shall judge the earth with righteousness, and all the people with his truth. Not yours, his. What's the song that you're singing to the Lord? If you're not singing a good song to the Lord, today is a good day to start. Bow your heads with me. Look inside yourself. Forget the press. Forget those who have told you how great you are. And allow the Holy Spirit to tell you what he's hearing, what he's smelling, what he's tasting. About your life. What kind of song is it? Blues? What kind of song is it? Joy? If you don't know him today, I recommend him to you. He has a way of bringing out the best song of your life. And you can sing. He'll make you happy. He'll sing. You'll sing because he'll set you free. His eyes, who's on the sparrow, will also watch over you. Secure your place in heaven as she has. And I encourage you today, no matter who you are and how high your station in life, your song is being recorded in heaven. Ask yourself, what does it say? What's it say? Father, forgive. Show your mercy, God. We have believed the press, that we have believed our followers. We believe our managers, and we believe those who have used us and admire us. But Lord, what do you think about us? What do you think about us, God? Father, show us by your Spirit. And make us to know your praise, to give you the honor and the glory that is due to your name. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Amen. Shall we stand as we prepare to leave this place? I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. I'm satisfied in just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the rest of the shine, I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old.
Walk the streets that are pure.